Greetings. Welcome to Parkville Presbyterian Church, a place where everyone is loved and everyone belongs. In this season, we have had to redefine what we mean by place. A place can be physical, emotional, intellectual, or spiritual. A place can be a building like the one behind me. A place can be wherever you are as you take in this service. As we invite you into the spiritual and emotional and intellectual space of worshiping with us, we invite you to attend to the physical place where you are. That might mean lighting a candle as a symbol of Jesus' presence with you in this moment of worship. That might mean taking some holy object from your home and putting it in front of you, something that reminds you of God's presence. We'd also invite you at this time to take out bread and grape juice, as we'll be taking communion later. And if you don't have bread or grape juice, consider bringing in some close approximation of it, because whatever you choose to partake in this morning, it will be the holy feast of communion for you today as we all join together in communion. Friends, why don't you come inside with me as we worship God together? What a beautiful opening song. Friends, today we conclude our worship series, Creation Stories, by experiencing the love of God through an animal, the love of God through a lost sheep.
But before we dig into that story, let's start with our time for young disciples. This is the moment in our worship service that is for the young and the young at heart. This is the moment in the worship service when we lift up that God is here for people of all ages, no matter what age you happen to be. So to those who are young or young at heart, I'd like to share a story. Today, we're going to hear a Bible reading about a lost sheep and how much God loves her. But before we get to that, I'd like to tell you a story about how God loves everyone who might be overlooked, everyone who might be forgotten. When God came to earth as Jesus Christ, at that time, people didn't always treat kids very well. Back then, most grown-ups thought that kids were to be seen and not heard, and they didn't always give kids the love that they needed. That can happen today, too. But back then, as much as now, God loves everyone, fully, beautifully, amazingly, no matter what. And there's a special place in God's heart for anyone who's overlooked or forgotten. With that in mind, let's turn to our story, which comes to us from the Jesus Storybook Bible. This is called The Friend of Little Children. Jesus' friends were arguing. Who was the most important helper in God's kingdom? They wanted to know. "I am," James said. "No, you're not," said Peter. "I am." "Nonsense," Matthew said. "I'm the cleverest." "No, you're not." "Yes, I am." "Are not." "Am too." And this silliness went on and on like that for quite some time. You see, Jesus' friends had started thinking that they had to do something to make themselves special to Jesus. That if they were the cleverest or the nicest or something, Jesus would like them the best. But they had forgotten something. Something God had been teaching his people all through the years, that no matter how clever you are or how good you are or how important you are, none of it makes any difference, because God's love is a gift. And as anyone will tell you, the whole thing about a gift is it's free. All you have to do is reach out your hands and take the gift. So while Jesus' friends were arguing, some people who knew all about getting gifts, in fact, you might say they were gift-getting experts, had come to see Jesus. Who were they? They were little children. Jesus' helpers tried to send the children away. "Jesus doesn't have time for you," they said. "He's too tired." But they were wrong. Jesus always had time for children. "Don't ever send them away," Jesus said. "Bring the little ones to me." Now, if you had been there, what do you think? Would you have had to line up quietly to see Jesus? Do you think Jesus would have asked you how good you'd been before he gave you a hug? Would you have had to be on your best behavior and get dressed up and not speak until you're spoken to? Or would you have done just what these children did? Run straight up to Jesus and let him pick you up in his arms and swing you and kiss you and hug you and then sit you on his lap and listen to your stories and everything you had to say. You see, children love Jesus, and they knew they didn't need to do anything special for Jesus to love them. All they needed to do was to run into his arms, and so that's just what they did. Well, after all the laughing and the games that day, Jesus turned to his helpers and said, "No matter how big you grow, never grow up so much that you lose your child's heart, full of trust in God. Be like these children. They are the most important in my kingdom." Amen. Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. It begins with Jesus talking to some overlooked, forgotten people, to well-known sinners and tax collectors, and then it concludes with him sharing a story about a lost sheep. You see, there were Pharisees and scribes who were there, and they objected to Jesus spending time with these notorious sinners. The Pharisees and scribes needed to hear about the lost sheep so they would know what Jesus was doing. This is the word of the Lord in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. Listen for God's word as it speaks. Now, all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus, and the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who need no repentance. Holy wisdom, holy words. Thanks be to God. In a way, we're all lost sheep. We have all been overlooked or forgotten at some point in our lives. Perhaps we were picked on in school. Perhaps we have been singled out for our religious views or our political views. Perhaps we have been sick and the illness that we had changed the way we relate to people, either by keeping them at an arm's distance or by sapping us of our strength. Perhaps we have been misunderstood. In one of those seemingly small moments of communication during a seemingly normal day, when an intimate partner or a good friend has no way of knowing how much they fail to hear us or how much they hurt us by failing to understand who we are. Perhaps we are lost sheep not because of something we did or something that happened to us, but because we are part of a group that is marginalized by society, part of a group that is made to be lost by the judgment of others. However, we are lost. In a way, we have all been lost sheep. In a way, we are all lost sheep right now, though the Pharisees and the scribes don't always realize it, or at the very least, they don't like to admit it. Our scripture reading today begins with a simple scene. Jesus is talking to tax collectors and sinners. And you may wonder about that term, sinners. After all, aren't we all sinners? After all, the Apostle Paul said, quoting the Psalms, that no one is righteous, no, not one, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are all sinners. And the scribes and the Pharisees in Jesus' time know this to be true. The scribes and the Pharisees are, at the end of the day, good people who are striving to follow all of God's rules and to live the best lives they can possibly live. And they know all the ways they fall short. In their times, the scribes and the Pharisees were middle-class religious groups with overlapping and interrelated membership. And the great mass of poor people had high regard for both groups. When the poorest folks in that time needed help, they turned to scribes and Pharisees. Those were the people who could read and write and interpret legal documents. Those were people who gave generously to support others in need. Those were people who volunteered in the soup kitchens of their day. The scribes and the Pharisees were good people. And they knew they were sinners. They were acutely aware of all the ways they fell short of the glory of God, and they were striving every day to do better. But they had one major blind spot. They recognized God's love for people like them, people who were striving to do good, people who had achieved something in life and were trying to achieve more, both for themselves and for their communities. They recognized God's love for people like them, and they thought they had earned that love through their hard work, and that other people had yet to earn God's love. Thus, the Pharisees and the scribes would never have done what Jesus is described as doing here, hanging out with tax collectors and sinners, hanging out with notorious, well-known sinners. Because you see, in order to earn the title sinners, these folks had to be particularly lacking in righteousness. They had to be brazen sinners, public sinners, people who sinned so much out in the open that everyone knew about their sins. Everyone sins. Everyone can be said to be a sinner, but in order to earn the title sinner, in a way that makes it a special title, in a way that conveys that everyone knows who you are, you have to be particularly brazen about your sinning, particularly public about your sinning, particularly notorious about your wrongdoing. And Jesus was hanging out with those kinds of people. These weren't people who were committing garden variety white lies or feeling the pang of lust in their hearts and only in their hearts. These were folks who sinned out in the open. They might have been prostitutes, known adulterers, criminals, thieves, biker gangs covered in tattoos, maybe even illegal immigrants. And as if that weren't bad enough, there were tax collectors in the group as well. People who were considered traitors by their fellow Israelites. Tax collectors worked for the Roman Empire and collected taxes for the state. They earned their living by collecting more than what the empire asked and keeping the rest for themselves. That made them cruel, exploitative traitors in the minds and hearts of many. And here Jesus was, hanging out with them, with tax collectors and with notorious, well-known sinners, people who were reviled by their community, people who the scribes and the Pharisees had good reason to look down upon, people who I would probably look down upon if I ever saw such people in my suburban world, but I rarely do. Such people rarely feel welcome in places like this. I think it's worth saying again that sometimes the sheep are lost because of choices they have made, and sometimes they are lost because of the judgments of society. Sometimes they are made to be lost by other sheep or by bad shepherds who judge them and hate them and refuse to let them into the sheepfold. But Jesus had a special heart for the lost sheep. Jesus had a special place in his heart for anyone who was overlooked, mistreated, or forgotten. And you didn't have to earn your way to that place. He loved sinners before they were reformed. He loved tax collectors before they changed their ways and became his disciples. He spent his time with people like this precisely because they were singled out and marginalized by their society. And he knew that those people needed God's tangible love more than anyone. And when he did spend time with good people, with the scribes and the Pharisees, with those upstanding citizens who made their families proud and served their communities well, his primary aim was to reform them, to help them expand their vision of who was welcome in God's kingdom and who was blessed with God's love. That's why he told them the story about the lost sheep and how the shepherd goes out of his way to find that one lost sheep, leaving the 99 who followed the rules and went where they were supposed to go behind. That's why God rejoices more over one notorious sinner who completely turns her life around than over 99 people who were always on the right track. That's a hard thing to hear for us 99 percenters. But it tells us about the next step of spiritual growth for us. It tells us about the people we need to look for, the people who are especially in need of God's tangible love. It's a reminder that if Jesus were here today, he would be with the family of George Floyd, not only because of their grief, but because of what they had experienced throughout their lives. And he would walk alongside Derek Chauvin, the officer who knelt on George Floyd and his family, because they are particularly in need of God's love at this time. If Jesus were alive today, he would be in cages with immigrant children on the U.S. border, because they need an unconditional expression of God's tender love. He would be in refugee camps in Jordan and Turkey. He would be with the homeless under a bridge in downtown Kansas City. He would be at Cherith Brook in northeast Kansas City, in a neighborhood that scares a lot of us. And he wouldn't shy away from anyone, based on the language they spoke, the clothes they wore, or anything they might have done, past or present. Over the last 12 weeks, we have been hearing creation stories. Our summer series was built on the stories and passages at the center of our intergenerational Sunday school curriculum, which led us through stories of water and food and plants and animals. Through it all, we heard messages that were not always explicitly about creation. We talked about discernment, generosity, courage, faith, and fear. We talked about appreciation for and stewardship of the environment, of course. And we talked about other issues of faith, especially God's love, which sings with joy through this whole created world. Throughout this series, we have learned that God speaks through creation. God speaks through the beauty, the joy, the ferocious unknown of the water. God speaks through the unconditional love of dogs and the beautiful singing of birds. God speaks through the rhythms of the soil, which needs to rest as much as people do. God speaks through the plants, even through the weeds, which the Lord allows to grow right alongside the flowering perennials. God speaks through individual parts of creation, but also through the whole created world, which joins in harmony to sing of God's love. For our part, it is our responsibility to care for this world, to care for every individual part of it, and also for the world as a whole. We have a responsibility to care for this world and to seek out and stand alongside the lost sheep within it. Sheep are intelligent animals. Sheep are intelligent animals, strong, resilient, and cautious around danger. Sometimes they need the love of a shepherd to lead them through unknown territory, to remind them of the God who stands with them and loves them, to walk with them through a place as dark as the valley of the shadow of death, so that they can get to a place of abundant life with clean water and clear meadows. Sheep are intelligent animals, and lost sheep often learn to be quite shrewd as they navigate an inhospitable world. And that is why, with a good shepherd to walk beside them, lost sheep can be found and be led into a moment of abundant life and joy, and then the whole world can rejoice alongside them, along with God, along with us. Amen. This is the communion table of our Lord Jesus Christ. When Jesus lived on earth, he invited everyone to the tables where he sat at the head. Jesus invited everyone to the tables where he sat at the foot. Jesus invited everyone to the tables where he sat somewhere in the middle. When Jesus was at the table, everyone could come. The lost sheep could come, the found sheep could come, the well and the sick, the rich and the poor, the young and the old, everyone was welcome at the tables Jesus convened. And just as he set no boundaries around his tables at his dinners, so we too set no barriers around this table. It's for everyone who hungers and everyone who thirsts. And even as you're joining us virtually, you are still very much welcome at this table. We are connected through the Holy Spirit. And so when you have communion at home, perhaps with bread and grape juice, or perhaps with something different, if you have communion at home with rice and wine, you will still very much have had communion with our Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever approximation you have for the elements that are here, let those be for you the joyful feast of the Lord's table, and let nothing stand in your way from enjoying this feast with him. Jesus is someone who came as the tangible love of God for us. When Jesus was manifested on earth, he was God's tangible love. He was the love of God made flesh and bones so that we could reach out and touch him and embrace him and know his presence. And so when Jesus was here, we saw God in ways that we'd never seen God before. We knew God's love more abundantly than we ever knew God's love before. We saw how God's love was a tangible thing and a real thing and something that was made manifest in flesh and bones, and we came to love that love so much that when Jesus was prepared for the next chapter of his journey, he left us with a way of continuing to experience that tangible love, and that's this meal, this communion with one another. And so on a particular Thursday, when Jesus was having supper with his closest friends, during a moment in that meal, he lifted up a loaf of bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you." As often as you share bread together, do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took a cup and poured it out. And he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant sealed in the substance of my life. As often as you share this cup together, remember me." And so in bread and in cup, we come to know him. We come to know him as someone who is tangible and real, someone who can be touched, someone who we can reach out and know is in our bones and in our guts. We're so glad for Jesus' presence in our midst, so glad that through a meal that we take together, we may know him through these elements and through each other. Amen.
Oh,
Friends, let us pray. God of grace and God of glory, we give you thanks for the many ways in which you have found us when we've been lost. Thank you for all the times when we have needed your presence and you have shown up for us. For all the moments when we've been lost, for all the moments when we've been overlooked and mistreated and forgotten, for all the moments when we've known what it's like to be that lost sheep. Thank you, Lord, for leaving the 99 behind and coming to find us. Lord, help us to remember those times when we've been lost. Help us to keep them fresh in our memory, that they may inform who we are and how we love others. Help us to remember all those times when we've been lost and found by you, that we might have empathy for the lost sheep among us, that we might recognize that some are lost by their own choices, some are lost by the choices of others, some are made to be lost by the judgments that are levied against them. Lord, with the empathy in our hearts from having been lost before, help us not to be one of the judgers. Help us not to be one of the excluders. Help us to be someone who eagerly looks for the lost sheep, who stands beside them, who offers them the tangible gift of your love in the ways that that love has been offered to us. Lord, help us to not just feel your love as something that we hold in our hearts. Help us to offer that love as a real thing, as a thing that people can feel when they need it most. Help us to remember those times when we've been lost and to have empathy for anyone else who might be lost, mistreated, forgotten, marginalized, sent away. Help us to be the people who stand beside them. And Lord, we ask this in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we transition to our call to discipleship, that moment in the worship service when we recognize that worship is more than what we do in this space. Worship is more than what we do during a formal time of offering our praise to God. It's what we do with every day of our lives. In every moment when we build relationships, every moment when we serve others, every moment when we make a choice for love, those are times when we're offering ourselves to God as well, and that too is worship. Worship. As we come to this call to discipleship time, I'd like to invite a particular disciple to come forward, and that's Sarah Lyons. Sarah is our new music director, who is starting with us today, and we're very glad to have her as part of our team here at Parkville Presbyterian. Sarah has previously worked at the First Presbyterian Church of St. Joseph, as well as a variety of other churches and a variety of other traditions. She comes to us deeply experienced, deeply talented, highly recommended, and we are so excited to have her on board. Sarah, I wonder if there's a word you might like to say to the folks in the church.
Yeah, I'm just really excited to be here this week in the office. I've already had the opportunity to meet a number of people, and I'm looking forward to getting to know everyone. And we do have my email set up, sarahlyons@parkvillepresby.org. So if you maybe have had to step away from music ministry or always wanted to give it a try, I would love to hear from you as I get to know our current music ministers. The more the merrier. I know during COVID-19, we can't gather at the same time, but there's a lot of chamber music options that I would love to explore with you all. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. We're really excited to have you here. So we're glad to welcome Sarah on board. One of the things I want to tell you about in this call to discipleship time is to make sure that I mention the opportunity for financial giving. In this season, the church is as open as it can be, serving as many people as it can in all the ways that they need. We serve people in emotional distress. We serve people who are experiencing the brokenness in their lives and may need financial help as a result of that. We are serving people who are in need by simply building community and offering worship. And whenever you participate in the church financially, you're not simply supporting an organization, you are participating in those ministries. And so we're very glad for all of you who are able to give. We're very glad for all of you who are willing to give. Giving options include a QR code on the bulletin that is underneath this video on the YouTube page. There's also a giving link at the bottom of the front page of our website, right in the middle. You can also give through a check to the church, and we're grateful for all the gifts that everyone gives, whether they are financial or otherwise, because it takes so many gifts and so many people to make a church work and to make it be what God calls it to be. One final thing I want to tell you about today is Kickoff Sunday. Kickoff Sunday is next Sunday, August 30th. During Kickoff Sunday, we are moving in-person worship from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. Online worship will still be accessible at the same times it's been accessible. But I would encourage you for Kickoff Sunday, if you would consider worshiping online with us at 10 a.m. so that you can join us right after worship for a special fellowship event. It's called a Blessing of the Backpacks, Briefcases, and Vocational Tools. And very simply what that means is that we recognize that the fall is a season of new beginnings for a lot of us. It's the start of a new school year. It's the start of a fresh season for many adults as well. And we want to bless you in whatever season of life you find yourself in with whatever work you happen to be doing. So we'd love for people to join us either in person or online, either downstairs in the fellowship hall or on Zoom. We'd love for you to join us, and we'd love for kids to bring backpacks or textbooks or footballs or whatever object that is important to them that they'd like to be blessed. We'd love for grown-ups to bring briefcases or calculators or hammers or laptops, whatever tools of your trade are important to you. This can be an object that's used in your profession. It can be an object that's used in a volunteer activity. But and whether you bring it virtually through that Zoom link or whether you bring it in person, we want to bless that object and lift it up and just acknowledge God's presence in this season of our lives. So I hope you'll join us next Sunday for Kickoff Sunday. I hope you'll worship with us at 10 a.m. so that you can then come to that blessing of the backpacks, briefcases, and vocational tools, which will be at 10:45, both online and in person. Also next Sunday, I'm beginning a new Sunday school class. It's called Virus as a Summons to Faith, Biblical Wisdom in Times of Grief, Loss, and Uncertainty. That class is gonna be at 9 a.m. and that is gonna be offered on both Zoom and in person. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you for being part of this worship experience. We are so grateful for each person who connects with us, for each person that is part of the body of Christ that is joined together through this church. And so, as we give thanks for you, we also invite you to go in peace, to find the lost, to love the lonely, to celebrate and care for this whole wide world that God has made. Amen.